New Zealand at ASX Day. And with that, I'd like to extend a special welcome to the Honourable David Parker, the Minister for Trade, who will shortly open the CEO Connect formally. The New Zealand High Commissioner to Australia, His Excellency Chris Seed, and also our friend, the New Zealand Consul General Billy Moore. Thank you all for your support today. To begin, I would like to acknowledge that this event is being held on the traditional lands of the Gadigal people. I pay my respects to elders past and present. Winston Churchill described, he was the first person to coin the phrase, the special relationship. He was talking about the UK and the US. Well, for ASX, our special relationship is New Zealand. Over the past 5 years, the number of New Zealand companies based have listed on ASX has grown from 16 to 57. The number of companies in our benchmark S&P ASX 200 index has increased from 2 to 7, and in the 300 from 5 to 10. We've seen market capitalisation of Kiwi companies go from $27 billion to $90 billion. So that's growth of market cap of over 230%. As investors, you've got a good reason to take interest in these trans-Tasman investment opportunities. The ASX-listed New Zealand cohort outperformed the broader market in 2017, with an average price performance of 15% versus 7% for the ASX 200. ASX-listed New Zealand companies represent a range of industry sectors, including technology, telecoms, healthcare, consumers, material and utilities. Ultimately, listing New Zealand companies on ASX gives Australian investors an expanded menu of investment opportunities as well as a broader selection of companies and to diversify your portfolio exposure. So with that background, to open New Zealand at ASX Day, I would like to welcome the Honourable David Parker, New Zealand Minister for Economic Development, Environment and Trade and Export Growth. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here at the launch of the NZ at ASX Day. I've just arrived for a couple of days here. We've got the annual Trans-Tasman meeting between our respective governments. It happens in either New Zealand or Australia every year. And it's the reason why New Zealand and Australia are the two most closely economically connected countries in the world that are separate countries, bar none. We've got a very, very successful interdependency going. 50% of New Zealand's foreign direct investment comes from Australia, works well for us, and also works very well for the companies that invest in New Zealand and their shareholders. I'm particularly interested in the journey of companies as they seek capital for themselves and liquidity and price maximisation for their shareholders. My own background includes a long time as an experienced CEO and company director and across a range of industries, and I've been involved before politics in a number of startup businesses in the agri-biotechnology space in New Zealand. As CEO, took one of them to the main board of the New Zealand Stock Exchange and was one of the founders of, in fact, I did the due diligence and was one of the first two employees of A2 Corporation. So I understand the challenges and the opportunities and the excitement of these journeys as companies grow. The ASX provides New Zealand companies with a wider platform, not just to raise capital, but also to gain knowledge from the specialist skill of the broader set of investors and analysts that sit in Australia, both as individual investors and also from your highly qualified and deep superannuation capital markets. So I'm very grateful for the ASX support of Trans-Tasman business, and I'm pleased to be here to support the day today. As you'll know, the ability to dual list companies was enabled by the Trans-Tasman Mutual Recognition for Security Offerings. This agreement, which entered into force in 2006, facilitates that Trans-Tasman investment between our two countries. Cross-border investment was given a further boost in 2015 when the ASX introduced the NZ foreign exempt category, which significantly reduced compliance costs for NZX listed companies to dual list here. As Max outlined in his introductory message, both countries have benefited from this. And of the 57 based New Zealand-based firms on the ASX, 38 of them are dual-listed on the NZX. These companies have gained higher exposure to bigger capital markets. In return, they're providing new investment opportunities for shareholders in fast-growing sectors, from fintech to advanced foods to healthcare to consumer services. They include companies that are fast becoming household names on both sides of the Tasman, like EBOS, Pushplay, Xero, Orion Health and Trademan. I think you'll have some interesting stories to hear today. In fact, I showed the CEO's Trademe as he came up here. I showed him my Trademe app on my phone. Investments in New Zealand companies and in New Zealand benefit from stable and globally competitive economies in both Australia and New Zealand. Like Australia, we've been well governed for a long time, and we've experienced many years of positive economic growth. We're ranked the easiest country in the world to do business, according to the World Bank's Ease of Doing Business Index. We've got a straightforward, business-friendly taxation environment that supports capital development, research and development, and foreign direct investment. And we have virtually no barriers to Australian companies. We've also got flexible immigration policies encouraging investors, entrepreneurs, business managers, and active government support for investment. We support open markets. We've just signed up with CPTPP, as your own government has, and we're actively seeking new investment. Lastly, I just mentioned that I am here to attend the annual Australia-New Zealand Leadership Forum. And this aims every year to make it easier for businesses that are domiciled in Sydney or Auckland to trade across the Tasman. We've made great strides in working together towards the same over the years, but we mustn't become complacent. There are always new challenges, whether it's in electronic commerce or other areas. We've got a lot to gain from ongoing cooperation, which I think is one of the reasons why New Zealand's economy is strong as it is, and I think it's been very beneficial for Australia as well. So I won't get in the way of you and some very interesting presentations. I know that there's someone else to speak before you see the class acts to follow, so I'll let you go.
Good afternoon. I'm Catherine Carver, Executive General Manager of NAB's Client Coverage Business, and it's part of our Corporate and Institutional Banking Division. It's really great to be here, and I welcome you to this fantastic opportunity connecting personal or potential investors, financial professionals, and the ASX 200 leaders. NAB connects with millions of customers both here and in New Zealand and broader shores every day. Our relationships include many ASX-listed companies for whom we're really proud to provide unique insights into all facets of banking and wealth management. As every savvy investor knows, most of them in the room, the best decisions are always those that are aligned with their own personal needs and values, as well as those of the company's goals and direction. These are important decisions, whether personal or corporate, that help drive our economies and nations forward and make innovation quite possible. From our perspective, events such as these, I sort of go to our purpose of backing the bold that moves both Australia and in this case New Zealand forward as well, and that perspective's really important. Our online trading business, nabtrade, continues to deliver insights and educational materials with the goal of making all Australians better investors. On behalf of NAB, BNZ and nabtrade, I'd like to thank the ASX for the opportunity to partner with them on this ASX CEO Connect series. Today is, as I mentioned, connecting you as shareholders with potential investments, bringing forward information and insights to help you make more informed decisions about your wealth that will build both your future and Australia, and dare I say New Zealand's future. It's a privilege to be here with six such talented CEOs and executives. Our relationship as a bank across the ditch with these individuals and their companies are a part of both NAB and BNZ's history of backing Australian and New Zealand businesses, corporations and institutions, and in some cases going back decades. I know you'll get a lot out of the conversations today, and I know you'll enjoy hearing from our special guests. NAB and BNZ looks forward to supporting your wealth and investment goals today and tomorrow. So thank you for joining us, and happy investing, successful investing. It's now my great pleasure to introduce the first company to present at the New Zealand edition of the ASX CEO Connect. Please join me in welcoming John McDonald, CEO of Trade Me.
Thank you, Catherine, for that kind introduction. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for giving up the time to be here. My name's John McDonald. I'm the CEO of Trade Me. I'm an old-timer there. I started back in 2003, and I've been the CEO of Trade Me now for around about 10 years. And I'm really looking forward to telling you about the business. I'll start by giving you an overview of who we are and what we do and how we provide value to our customers. I'll then talk a little bit about the work we've been doing over the past few years to build the business and to grow it. I'll give a bit of a snapshot as to where we sit today, and then I'll talk a little bit about the future. So, to give you an overarching view of Trade Me, our vision is to make life better for New Zealanders through online experiences that they love. And more specifically, we do that by providing a trusted venue for two people to meet, connect, and either undertake a transaction or to enter into some kind of relationship. In practical terms, that means that we provide the three big, what I'll call the classifieds verticals of motors and real estate and employment. And I don't usually use this frame of reference, but to an Australian audience, I will, where you can think of us as New Zealand's version of car sales and realestate.com.au and Seek. And those three classifieds verticals together provide around 55% of our revenue. So in financial terms, they are now the majority of our business. We also provide what I'll call our general items marketplace. And that means people buying and selling everything from little remote control doodackies to watches, to shirts, to lecterns even, to and from each other. And that's now about 30% of our revenue. It's a mix of new goods and used goods. And it's actually our founding business line. That's where we started. And you can think about us as New Zealand's version of eBay in that context. And then we have a portfolio that stretches beyond that, where we do everything from life and health insurance comparison through to rental holiday accommodation through to display advertising across our entire network. Now, even when I describe Trade Me in that fashion, to a degree I'm missing a core element where we have, through all of those endeavours, built up an extremely strong and warm relationship with the New Zealand public. And the Honourable Minister David Parker did show me the Trade Me app on the home screen of his phone, and I would have been disappointed if it weren't there. And it's that kind of engagement and that kind of affection that has led to us being recognised in New Zealand as one of the top 10 most loved brands and one of the top 10 most influential brands as well. To translate that into numbers a little bit, we started back in 1999. Today, right today, is in fact our 19th birthday. So if you happen to visit Trade Me on a desktop browser, you'll see our little logo, Kevin the Kiwi with a birthday hat on. We were originally privately held, then we were owned by Fairfax, between 2006 through to 2011. Then we IPO'd an issue price of $2.20. We're now trading a little bit above $4 Australian to give a total return since listing there of 124%. I will actually also just echo the Minister's remarks in regards to New Zealand being a wonderful place to do business, including that point about ease of doing business. But the way I'd also describe New Zealand is, whilst we're small, we're very well formed. And that means it's a simple, homogenous market. We don't have to worry about state taxes versus federal things. There aren't these multiple layers of hoops to be jumped through. We have great internet penetration, a good payments and banking network, good logistics, all these things that lead to a high-performing economy. That's one that we've certainly found has been helpful to us as a business. Now, if I turn to the journey that we've been on over the last few years, this just gives our last 5 years' financials, and you can see there our revenue growth has been quite consistent over that time. We have been through a period of quite strong investment in the business. And when we IPO'd, when we became a publicly listed company back in 2011, we had quite an extreme starting position where we had an 80% EBITDA margin, or profit margin. So for every dollar of revenue, we had about 20 cents of expenses, and that's all. But the reality was we were running too lean. And so we've been through a period of reinvesting in the business. We've grown the staff at Trade Me from roughly 200 at the beginning of this this journey through to about 600 now, and we're fundamentally better equipped to convert on the opportunities that are in front of us. That period of strong reinvestment came to an end last year, and so we returned back to good profit growth, as you can see there on the right-hand side. One of the things that we did do during all that period is improve the products that we could offer our customers and the utility that we could provide them, and we got better at selling those. And we call those premium products, and I mention this both to show the momentum that we have behind this and talk about the opportunity that sits there, where we can continue to provide great opportunity for our customers like car dealers, real estate agents, recruiters, retailers to grow their own brands online and to sell their products. And we have a great momentum that we continue to plan to continue in that regard. And just having looked at a multi-year view, I'll now turn to a snapshot of our last 6 months' financial results, which are hot off the press, actually. We released these only yesterday. So we recorded revenue growth of up 7% year on year. Within the business, our classifieds that I've mentioned, in aggregate, they grew 14% year on year. That's where the strong growth is coming from. And we can see great runway through those premium products I just mentioned to continue with that growth. The marketplace, our general items marketplace I mentioned, was up 1% year on year in terms of revenue. That is our mature business largely, and as I mentioned, we're 19 years old, and that was our founding business line, that selling of used goods to and from each other. Where there is growth and opportunity there is in the sale of new goods, and I'll talk about that more in a moment. We did grow our expenses over the half. That was up 9%, but a portion of that was what we term cost of sales, where in some parts of the business we enter into partnerships where we share that revenue. And when you take that away, our expenses grew 6% year on year to give a profit that was up 3% for the period. So that's really just to give you a bit of a snapshot as to exactly how we traded, hot off the press, as I say, yesterday. Now what I'll do is go into each of the big elements of the business that I've mentioned briefly so far, talk about how they work, how we make our money, and the prospects in front of them. So first I'll start with Trade Me Motors. And the sale of cars in New Zealand is very similar to Australia, but just to mention, probably one difference that's worth mentioning is that New Zealand stopped assembling and manufacturing cars a long time ago, and so dropped import restrictions quite a long time ago as well, which means that there's a greater proportion of Japanese imports, and there has been less barriers to importing cars or becoming a car dealer, which has meant for a flourishing market of, on average, smaller car dealers that sit than in Australia. That's been advantageous for us because that fragmented supply base works really well in a classifieds model or an online platform model. Facilitate the sale of cars both from private individuals to private individuals and from dealers also to private individuals. It's about half and half. We make money by either charging people to list their car for sale or for car dealers we will charge them a monthly subscription to for their inventory and then allow them to consume these premium products I've mentioned on top of that. Moving on to real estate. Again, the market is quite similar to Australia, and New Zealand real estate has been having a great run over the last few years. Perhaps the only thing to note is that in this case, with it being New Zealand being a small country, there is a concentration of supply or listings or inventory from a fairly small number of big franchises. A lot of the franchises that exist over here as well, like the Ray Whites of the world and the Harcourts. The way we make money there, again, is to charge people to list their advertisement then beyond that, the premium products that we provide that allow them to improve the prominence of the listing, which means that there'll be more buyers for the house, or crucially, especially for real estate agents and officers, we provide them the means to promote their own brands and to build their own presence online, which is very important to them. Moving on to jobs, a very, very similar market to Australia. I should mention in both motors and in real estate, we have a good number one position in both of those markets. In the case of jobs, we go toe-to-toe with SEEK. SEEK were, in fact, across there earlier than we were, but we've been able to grow share against them and be effectively pound-for-pound peer to SEEK over in New Zealand. And finally, of our big business units, our general items marketplace. And as I mentioned, that's a mix of new and used goods. The used goods part of that business is mature, and so the total value of sales we facilitated in used goods for the half that I just mentioned declined 2.6%. But new goods is growing, and that's really us participating in online retail. So the activity there grew by 5% year on year. And we see online retailers continuing to grow strongly for years to come as a proportion of total retail. So that's a great structural growth opportunity for us right there. We make our money generally by taking a commission on successful sale of an item, but again, there are these premium products that allow people to promote their inventory to make it more likely to sell or to sell at a better price. We also helped retailers promote their own brands and to acquire customers online as well. And this is just a useful snapshot to give you a bit of a sense as to the big categories within our marketplace. As you see, home and living there, the biggest business, farming industry, motors, parts, sports. And the two interesting things about this is one is the good diversification within this business across multiple categories. The other thing that's good is that a lot of these categories are bigger items, harder to ship internationally, and well suited to local commerce rather than international commerce, which is good for us when it comes to defence against global players. And so all of our business, our marketplace for these reasons, when you look at the our categories and real estate, motors, jobs, they're all very regional businesses in that regard. And I think we've been able to grow and be strong in New Zealand and have that as our turf, and that's the way we plan to keep it. So when you step back and look at that, what does it mean that we have as our advantages? And there are a few. The first is that in a local context, we are big and we have great scale. And these businesses like ours are subject to what we call network effects, where buyers want to be where all the inventory is, where all the sellers are. The sellers want to be where all the buying audience is, and that's a relationship that builds momentum, and we're on the right side of that equation. We have great trust with the New Zealand public, and we work hard to keep that. We have great understanding of them, both at a human level, but we also have fabulous data that we're doing more and more with in terms of improving our offering. And as I mentioned, we have a great relationship with the New Zealand public and their affection. We often talk about people having their Trade Me story, where we've done something to surprise or delight people, and they remember that, and that's something that we're very careful that we preserve and that we nurture. So when we look at our plans ahead, I could talk to you about each of those different business lines for an hour, but I'll be pulled off the stage well before that. So just in a minute or two, I'll really distill it down to three things that we're looking at across the entire business. The first is to make sure that we know our customers intimately and are building stronger and stronger relationships with them in a local context. That's part science, part art, really. The science part is making use of that fabulous data that we have with great breadth across the New Zealand population, but also insights into key life events like finding a new house, finding a new job, moving cities, browsing our baby gear category for the first time. All of these things are very, very powerful insights, and we have a great data set that we're making sure we make the most of. We're also making sure that we get out and talk with our customers and engage with them at a human level as well as we possibly can. The second thing that we're doing is broadening that offering so that we can be as useful as possible to people, be as strong as possible, and make more money. So that's everything from improving how you can pay people on TradeMe, for example, how you can ship items, the valuation data for a house or a car, building up a repository of candidates for recruiters. All of these things that we can do that sit nicely alongside our existing businesses, but make us more useful to our customers and make us stronger as well. And we're doing that in a way that is as effective as possible. And we are a little company down in the corner of the world, and we do have competitors, everyone from Amazon to Facebook to Seek. And all of these companies have thousands of employees and are way bigger than us. But we've been able to survive and thrive in New Zealand by being very effective with what we do and very accurate with how we work. And we'll make sure that we keep that up. And so in summary, if I were to describe to you TradeMe, we do have this vision to make life better for New Zealanders through online experiences they love. And we do that through a number of businesses, each which have strong market positions and are robust in their models and time-tested, really, where for each of them we've been running at a minimum a decade and up to our founding business line now for 19 years. And we are on the right side of structural migration still from bricks and mortar retail to online retail to print advertising to online retail, and we're making sure that we make the most of that. And through that, we are growing well. We also provide a good dividend yield, which is around about 80% of NPAT is what we've paid out historically. And all of that together makes for a wonderful, balanced investment that I would encourage you to consider. Well, thank you very much for your time, and I'll stop there, but I believe I can take questions.
Thank you, John. Indeed, you can. So I would ask that anyone who wants to ask a question put their hand up and wait for the microphone.
You mentioned some figures, and then NetPAT and dividend. Was that Australian currency or New Zealand?
Oh, it's an excellent question. The share price numbers that I put up of $2.20 and $4 was Australian, but I confess the summary I put up of our half-year results, including that NPAT number of $46 million, was New Zealand dollars.
How does your subscribers look like in number, and what's the growth rate?
So we will have, if you look at our membership base, and it's a great question, we're one of the wonderful things about TradeMe is that right from the very beginning, when people use TradeMe, we ask them to be a member. So rather than just people, say, casually visiting to look at a house for sale online, all the people that visit us are generally members. And so we have a membership base of over 3 million. We will have around about 800,000 people who visit us each day. In terms of activity, that is still growing when you look at it from the main measure that we use is, we call it sessions, but it's people engaging with us, be it on a desktop or a mobile device, what have you. And that is still growing. It's down to sort of single digits percent, but that number is still growing.
One more question.
Just a quick question. Great presentation. Just wanted to know whether TradeMe has plans to expand to Australia. And the other question is on dividends. As I understand it, dividends are not franked in Australian terms, so there's a disadvantage in investing in New Zealand shares. Are there any proposals to the respective government to allow a similar franking capability for Australian investors?
Without deflecting the question too much to the minister here, I'll actually mention on the dividends question, we actually pay a supplementary dividend, which aims to address that, the franking credit issue that you mentioned there. So that aims in part to address that. And I confess, whilst I was thinking about that, the first part of your question slipped out of my mind.
How much room for expansion in New Zealand and also in Australia? Is that, yes. Can you replicate the model here, and what are the challenges in the Australian context?
Yeah, it's a great question. There is a lot of room for growth in New Zealand, and that sits both in our existing businesses, then where we can expand alongside them, and where we can do completely new things. And we tend to have a focus front and centre on New Zealand. It's where we're strong. And when you look at our competitive advantages, a lot of them are very New Zealand-centric. And so our ambitions to come across to Australia would really sit if we saw there was something new that we wanted to do in New Zealand, then we would start, and we thought we were early enough to market, we would potentially do that in Australia. There are actually a couple of examples of that already where we acquired a business a few years ago called MotorWeb, who do vehicle data and reports, and they have an Australian operation that's doing extremely well. Another example is that we made a minority investment in a company called Harmony, who do peer-to-peer lending. So they're similar to SocietyOne, and they have Australian aspirations. And so that's a new enough model, we believe, to be able to have a go at Australia. We will not have a go at Australia around those traditional classifieds of motors, real estate, and employment. Car sales, REA, Seek, Domain, etc., they're too strong, and those models favour that strong player too much, so we won't be going in that regard. Thank you all very much for your time. I really appreciate the opportunity to talk with you. Thanks.
Thanks, John. That was a great presentation. Just bear with me all, please, just for a minute of housekeeping before I introduce our next speaker. For those of you in the room with us today, there is a raffle to be drawn after the very last speaker sits down. So I do hope you'll stay with us for that. There is also, for those of you who would like to earn professional development points, there's a quiz that's available online after the event. If you need to know more about that, you can grab one of our helpful staff to find out. And the link for the quiz is at the bottom of the YouTube broadcast link to watch the online version. And also, each CEO who presents today will do a short video with nabtrade. And those videos, which are more of a personal kind of interview to find out a little bit about the person and the company, are available both on the ASX landing page for CEO Connect and nabtrade after the event. Now, our next speaker is the chairman of Gentrack Group, John Clifford. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Just to introduce myself briefly, I've been the chairman of Gentrack since 2007. A quick history on the business, because most of you won't have heard of us, I expect. Gentrack started in the 1980s as an Auckland-based computer hardware business. And like many of those, it moved into software in the late 1990s, in particular with the deregulation of the New Zealand energy industry. Since then, Gentrack has grown into Australia and the UK, and also into the water utility industry. The energy markets in New Zealand and Australia and the UK are similar, so that was a comfortable expansion for us. The company was in private equity ownership from 2007 to 2014, and we listed on the ASX and NZX in June 14 at a price of Aussie 219. And a market valuation of $159 million. And I'm pleased to say we're about three times up over 3 years including the dividends we paid for investors, just over 3 years. So it's been a successful story for investors who invested with us at IPO. What does Gentrack do? We provide mission-critical and deeply embedded software for essential services: energy, electricity and gas utilities, water utilities, and airports. Our software combines deep operational expertise and intellectual property with a very efficient platform that lets those our customers, the utilities and the airports, lower their cost to serve and improve their delivery to their customers. So a quick snapshot of, in a bit more detail, of what the business does. Firstly, on the utility side, and the airports and utilities are quite separate businesses. The utilities business is about 80% of revenue and profit. And what we do in the utility area is the complete meter to cash cycle, from processing the electricity meter reading through applying the tariffs to sending the bill to the consumer and to managing that consumer in the utilities records through the cycle of whether they've paid or not, what their name is. And if you call up the call center of your utility, the operators would be looking at Gentrack screens. That is actually a more complex business than you might think, particularly when you go into the industrial and commercial electricity market. And about half the revenue of big electricity and gas companies in most places is industrial and commercial customers. And very often they have a one-off bilateral deal with their utility, which, if you're, for example, Coles supermarkets in Australia, might have 2,000-3,000 electricity meters feeding one bill every month. And that might be a unique deal between Coles and their retailer. With the residential market, there are a whole plethora of different tariffs in different regions and a lot of government regulation to comply with. So it's actually quite complicated. But the real complexity comes in, and our real deep IP, in the area of market interaction. And this is the back office plumbing in the utility industry, where they deal with which meter reading belongs to which retailer. If you think about it, if you change retailer, somebody in the system's got to switch your meter reading from going to one party to another, and then that utility has to pay your local poles and wires companies, lines companies as they call them in New Zealand, or distributors here, have to pay them for the use of the poles and wires in your suburb, and then they have to settle for that electricity in the generation market. And that back office functionality is very complicated, and our software facilitates that for utilities. Some of our customers, the names that you would know, we have 80 utility customers around the world in New Zealand, Australia, and the UK, and I'll talk a bit about more about that in a second, but some well-known names include Origin in Australia, Alinta over in New Zealand, Genesis, Trustpower, Meridian. So we're in the largest utilities in Australia and New Zealand, but we're also very strong in the next tier down and in the startup utilities. And I'll talk later about a lot of innovation that's happening, even a revolution, you might say, in the utility industry. And we're very active in supporting those smaller utilities to come into the market. On the airport side, which, as I said, is about 20% of our business, the bit of our software that we would all have seen is the flight information displays. That's actually just the tip of the functionality that our software delivers. It also runs what's known as the central operating database of the airport, which tracks everything that's going on, which flights are at which gates and so on. Very complex function that lets the airport plan a month, a year, 5 years ahead about the capacity they have and which airlines and aircraft will be at which gate. And then in the short term, tactically, to using artificial intelligence now, reorganize that optimally. Not just the gate that the aircraft should go to, but how many people are getting off there, which baggage carousels, which ground handling crew, which security roster on the departing flight. So a very complex system. And recently, we've expanded the functionality of our software to passenger tracking. Airports are increasingly monitoring the movement of people through the airport using video recognition and mobile phone tracking, so they can understand where the pinch points are in the airport and if there are too many people in a certain area and how long people are spending in different parts of the terminal. And also the complex, many of the, as you all would know, if you've traveled through airports, they're nowadays very upmarket shopping malls often, and the airports typically charge rent to the shops and restaurants in the airport based on their turnover. Our software tracks that turnover, indeed in some cases linking it to every flight, gate and passenger. So the airport has a very full picture of where they're making money. And for example, to give you a little perspective of what's possible, they might know that a certain flight, the customers on that flight spend a lot of money on sunglasses and they're going on holiday. That flight might be located quite near to the departure terminal, whereas a flight full of miserable businessmen who don't spend anything in the retail outlets might be put miles away because it doesn't matter that they don't spend time shopping. So airports that use our software are pretty much every, well, most of the airports in Australia and New Zealand, so Sydney, Melbourne, Brisbane, Auckland, Wellington, and so on, but also up in Asia, Hong Kong, JFK, London City. So we're in quite a lot of the world's tier one airports. So what is our addressable market in those core regions? In the UK and Ireland, there are 88 energy companies and 32 water companies, and we know them all and regularly meet them. We think we're in the number two position in the UK market. We've got 37 energy companies as our customers and three water utilities. In the UK, interestingly, water is in private ownership, and you can shop around if you're a business and buy water from a different utility, a bit like you can with electricity in Australia. We're actually, if you measure our market share in the sense of the number of energy retailers, we're the number one, but SAP and Oracle, the big global heavyweights in corporate ERP systems, have a legacy market position in the biggest utilities in the UK. And although we're in some of those now with niche solutions, that puts us technically in the number two position. Just in the last year, we opened a small office in Singapore because they're going through the process, like Australia, New Zealand, and the UK, of separating the poles and wires, the generation and the retail. And we, in the last 6 months, we've signed up two of the startup energy retailers in that market. In New Zealand, we're the market leader, our home country. There are 42 energy brands. We're in about half of the market by end consumers, and more than that in terms of the number of retailers. Australia, there are 40 energy companies and 47 water companies. We're the number two with 12 energy utilities using our software and 9 water companies. In fact, we're the market leader in water billing in Australia. And Australia is interestingly seen as a global leader in terms of the tarification and charging for water. There was a while where we were quite worried we were going to run out of water in Australia. And a lot of infrastructure was put in to create the ability to motivate people to conserve water with tariffs. For example, you would have to, if they needed to implement it, pay more for water if you used more of it compared to last year on an individual house basis. So that stood us in good stead and was very relevant when we went into the UK market in water. And then in airports, we're in 20% of the top airports in the world, but there are actually 10,000 airports globally, and we're very strong in the tier two sector. As I mentioned, over 110 airports use our software. So that's a snapshot. We've been quite, just on that point, we've been quite disciplined to stay in these markets, Australia, New Zealand, and we went into the UK about 7 or 8 years ago, because we felt that there was lots of temptation to go into other markets and opportunity, but we felt we had to be a market leader and have a big presence on the ground and a significant market share to really make money. So it doesn't make any sense to have one customer in Japan, for example. The costs of supporting the software and building it for that market don't justify being there unless you have a significant market share. But we do have opportunities and we do look at new markets. Our results going back, actually our track record goes back much longer than that, but when we listed, we showed data since 2009. Our average growth rate's been about 15%, and we make about 32% EBITDA on revenue last year. So that's a solid track record of circa 15% growth. About 60% of our revenue each year is recurring, and about 90% of our revenue each year comes from our existing customers. So we're very deeply embedded in all those utilities. They come to us when there are regulatory changes or they want to do something new, and hence only about 10% of our revenue each year comes from new customers that we've added. Our 32% EBITDA margins, and we use EBITDA, depreciation's almost immaterial. There's no significant capital expenditure in the business other than computer hardware. So EBITDA is the metric the analysts use to look at us, but it's more or less the same as EBIT. We do have some amortization of legacy goodwill that existed through transactions predating the IPO, but they're non-cash accounting costs. And I feel that our 32% margins, which are high for the industry, reflect the deep intellectual property and our competitive advantages in the markets we're in. Very strong cash generation, about 80% of our NPATA, net profit after tax, but before amortization, is paid out as a dividend each year. We made, for the first time, a couple of acquisitions last year. We bought a company called Juniper in the UK, which actually gave us that market-leading position. A business called CA Plus in Malta, and a business called Blip in Denmark. And they were the Blip and CA Plus were airport technology solutions that we added to our existing position. Over the last 18 months, we've actually, as we've become a much bigger company, we've built regional management teams in the UK, New Zealand, and the UK. We used to run the group centrally from New Zealand, but we now have a full management infrastructure in each of those markets who are in charge of marketing and winning and having a leading position in their local markets. It can't be, we're of a size now where we can't command that all and run that all from New Zealand. And we have a first-class senior management team in place. Ian Black, the CEO, was the local CEO of SAP, which is one of our big competitors. He was with SAP for 18 years. And he really has led quite a transformation of the senior executive team in the last 2 years since he joined, since the IPO. Just giving you a bit more color on our revenue model, I mentioned that about 60% of our revenue is recurring. About 30% of our revenue is contractually recurring, i.e. our customers pay a monthly or an annual fee to use the software. And then about another 30% comes from services to those customers when they want to change their billing system or give away flyby points or comply with regulatory changes, of which are fairly frequent. And then the rest of the revenue is software licenses and new wins and big projects. So there's a cut of the revenue pie. But I think the important thing is that, and it certainly proves out in our model, we've got a high level of recurring and reliable income. By region, 84% of our revenues are outside New Zealand now. Australia is our biggest market, about 44%, 31% in Australia. Our strategy is to stick to our knitting. We think we've got a very solid market understanding, high levels of intellectual property. And our plan is just to stick to our utility and airports niche in markets that we understand. We think there's plenty of growth for the next 5+ years in those markets. We're investing in our products, in our operating model, and in partnerships to enable us to grow faster. I think we've always been capacity constrained over the last 10 years that I've been involved in Gendrec. We've always had to struggle to recruit people and grow quickly enough to meet demand. And we're now investing in our model to enable us to lift our organic growth rate. A trend in all enterprise software increasingly is delivering solutions in the cloud as software as a service. And the utilities are probably at the back of that queue in terms of adopting those new business models, but we are seeing them growing in that market. And we will continue our track record of shareholder returns through paying out 70 to 80% of profits. The last thing I'd say on Gentrack is we're very much leveraged to the utility revolution. There's a lot changing in the utility market. In particular, the dominant players from the era of public ownership are losing market share quite fast in all of our markets. And we are leveraged very much to the growth of those new and mid-tier players in the energy market. Very often, those players don't just want to buy our solution, they want to buy managed services where we run that technology platform for them. So they just focus on marketing and tariffs and the things that they do and leave the technology solution to us. There are lots of new business models coming in. In the last few months, it's interesting to note that Shell has bought one of the bigger energy retailers in the UK and has bought the biggest on-the-road charging network for electric cars in the UK. So there are very interesting things happening. There's quite a clear pattern of the big oil companies entering the energy retail markets. And a lot of utilities have become multinational operators. They were previously just in Australia or just in New Zealand or just in the UK, but particularly in Europe, we've seen the emergence of global energy retailers. There's a lot of customer-driven technologies and smart home technologies that are now just beginning to touch on the energy retail market. And this is a fast thing that is certainly in the forefront of all energy retailers' mind. How will they harness smart home technologies, in particular the ability to control electrical load, for example, charging your electric car in the future, with cheaper tariffs? They can offer you much cheaper tariffs if they can actually control when you do things that you don't really care about the time you do them in. So that's my presentation. Happy to take any questions.
Thank you, John. If you have a question, please raise your hand and wait for a microphone.
Thanks for the wonderful presentation. Just a quick one. What percentage of your revenue goes into your R&D budget?
I don't think of it that way, and many technology companies quote the percentage of their revenue that goes into R&D because they're trying to build a new technology or build dominance. For us, we have about 40 people in our R&D team, 43 people, I think, at the moment, and that delivers the R&D spend we need. I actually can't quote you the number off the top of my head as a percentage of revenue, but I don't think of it that way. I more think of it as what do we need to spend to have the leading products in the market. So it isn't often when that figure is quoted, people think of it as a leading indicator of future growth, technology spend. In our case, it isn't.
Could you tell me whether your major competitors are global or are they mostly in Australia and New Zealand?
Yes.
And the inference of the question really is, what are your market threats?
Yes, so our global competitors are SAP and Oracle. They traditionally had the lion's share of the biggest utilities, but we've been making very good inroads into their markets, basically with a superior functionality product at lower cost. So in our local markets, New Zealand, Australia, and the UK, we have some smaller competitors who are just local to those markets. We really don't, other than SAP and Oracle, we don't see any other competitor across all those spaces. The airport technology space is very fragmented. The history was that many airports just had their own IT department and they built all this stuff themselves in the airport. That was common practice 10, 15 years ago. We're moving to a world now where we're a leading player, but there are two or three other companies around the world who have done similar things. Often they've spun out of a single airport and they're offering a solution. So there is no, we're a major world player, but there is no other dominant player in our markets in the airport space.
Can you tell me the dividend in the last year?
The dividend payment last year was 12 point something cents.
Last question.
That's a New Zealand sense.
Thank you for the information. One question, or maybe two, okay. firstly, what happened in 2014? I noticed there's a dip in revenue. The reason for this question is really what are the risk factors that we have to look into in the future? The second thing is I can see there are a diversified geographical, regional source of revenue. So how is the foreign currency, foreign exchange risk being managed?
Yes, good question. So we do quite big projects for utilities, and depending on when a project starts and finishes, it can impact our revenue recognition. So whenever we talk about our results or our give people guidance, we always say it's subject to the timing of projects, particularly true if you look on us on a six-month basis. I don't think our revenue did dip in 2014, but there was a period when it was, after the IPO, when it was our growth wasn't the sort of 15% average, and that just reflected the timing of projects through that year. As to foreign currencies, we have more or less, you know, we have revenue in pounds, Aussie dollars, and New Zealand dollars. We've got local costs against those revenues, so really it's only our profit. And our software, of course, comes at effectively no marginal cost from R&D in New Zealand. There's transfer pricing under the tax regimes, but in truth, we have local costs that match our local revenue for delivery. Our profits are exposed to foreign exchange, and our results would look much better if you measured them in pounds, but we've generally taken the view that apart from hedging cash remittances, you know, if we have a pile of pounds and we want to bring them back, we tend to look, okay, what's the best time to do that? Can we hedge that cash repatriation? But we can't actually hedge out the inherent foreign exchange exposure in the business, and we don't try to do that. Generally, we're comfortable with our cost base being predominantly in New Zealand and Australia, and if there's an imbalance, it's you know, the costs are higher here than they are in the UK, but we're happy with that exposure. It's a good place to have software developers and our head office.
Thank you very much, John.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Richard Thompson, who's the Chief Financial Officer of MetLife Care.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here. I'd like to thank the organisers for the opportunity to speak to this audience. I'm Richard Thompson, the CFO at MetLife Care. I've joined the company relatively recently, in late September, early October last year. And what I thought we'd do this afternoon is go through two or three elements of the business at the risk of talking through the economic model that we use in the retirement village space. In New Zealand, I thought I would touch on that briefly to begin with, talk about the industry, the way it's structured in New Zealand, MetLife's place in that sector, and what we're doing in terms of growth of the business, what the growth agenda over the next two or three years is. For those that aren't familiar with the sector in New Zealand, the retirement village model centres around what we call an occupational right agreement. And essentially what we do is build a property for the first time and sell an ORA, occupational rights agreement, at a purchase price that's at a value that's equivalent to the purchase price of an independent living unit or service department. And in exchange for that ORA, the resident is entitled to rights to occupy that unit or service apartment for as long as they like. On vacation, whether where a resident either moves into a care home or a hospital or may even die, the proceeds from the ORA are refunded to the resident, less what we call a deferred management fee. Which in the case of MetLife Care represents 30% of the purchase price of the ORA. The deferred management fee is then applied, or a portion of the deferred management fee is applied to refurbishing the unit that's been vacated, and any surplus DMF is retained by the company, as well as any capital gain that's accrued on the unit. And that unit is recycled many times like that through its natural life. The sector in New Zealand is very strongly governed. There's a Retirement Village Act that has a whole range of consumer protections in place to ensure just that. And there is independent statutory oversight of the sector. So there is a statutory supervisor that's appointed to each registered village who reports back to the village independently and formally once a year. So that's a description of the model. MetLife Care's place in the industry in New Zealand, we're one of the three largest listed players. There's 30,000 retirement units in New Zealand, and roughly 1,900 being built each and every year currently. Half the market is served by private operators, and the other half of the market is served by five listed entities, three of which are rather large, and MetLife Care is one of the three large operators. What distinguishes MetLife Care from some of the other operators in the sector is the location and composition of our asset portfolio. Now, we have 24 properties located in the North Island and focused principally in the Auckland and Bay of Plenty region. So the vast majority of the units' properties are located there. We have some properties in the Upper North Island and a handful of properties in the Lower North Island, but we have an Auckland region and Bay of Plenty concentration. And the reason that that's very significant, or a significant point of distinction for the company, as you can see from these graphs, they're a little hard to read probably from the back of the room, but Auckland has the highest population concentration in the company by a long way, and as a consequence of that is very much at the heart of the economic growth engine of the economy. Two consequences naturally fall out of that. One is the graph on the right-hand side of the page. You can see there the orange bar is average median house prices in the Auckland region relative to the rest of the country. As you can see there, average median house prices are significantly higher than other parts of New Zealand. And on the left-hand side, the number of people entering the 75-year plus age group over the next 10 or 15 years is again materially higher than the balance of the country. And you can see there in the case of Auckland, over the course of the next 15 years, the number of people in that part of the demographic is expected to double in that part of the country. We're not doctrinal or doctrinaire about where we look to develop new villages, and we're certainly looking outside of the Auckland region for future growth opportunities, but this has been a real strength of MetLife Care's portfolio, which has allowed us to deliver reliable current and future deferred management fee earnings and excellent resale margins or capital gains. Embedded value, and I hasten to add that this is a non-GAAP measure of financial performance, but it's an important one nonetheless. Embedded value per unit provides an indication of the cash potential of the portfolio in future. If we were to collapse the portfolio in theory today and realise the embedded capital gains and deferred management fees in the portfolio, less what we need to pay away to residents in terms of the settlement of the existing resident liabilities. There's an enormous amount of value in the current portfolio, which currently stands at around 1.1 billion New Zealand dollars. And as you can see from that graph, is grown quite significantly over the last few years. Part of what's driving that is if you look back into the history of the company, many of the properties, or half of the properties that entered into the portfolio, started off their existence as lifestyle villages and were populated by 55, 60-year-olds who entered the village for the first time 15, 18 years ago. And what's happened over the passage of time is those residents have got older and the cumulative capital gains that have started to accrue in the portfolio have become very meaningful indeed. So actually on a per unit basis, it's 277,000 New Zealand dollars per unit today in embedded value in the company. What has also distinguished MetLife Care in a negative sense in the market in New Zealand has been a historic lack of development growth ambition. Glenn Sowery, who's the current CEO of the company and joined the organisation 2 years ago, has front and centre of the company's strategy the desire to turn our development ambition around. 2 years ago, our production of new development units was just over 100 per year. In FY18, we're a 30 June balance date, we are on track to deliver 254 new beds and care beds and independent living units. And our ambition by financial year 20 is to move into a run rate of production in excess of 300 independent living units per year. So as I say, one of the things that's negatively differentiated MetLife Care over the last few years is this development appetite, and that is an area that the current management of the organisation are very concentrated on improving. Our development team internally are unrecognisable from the development team of 2 or 3 years ago, and we're making solid progress in this regard. I've put up on the board there just three projects. We won't get into any detail on any particular one of them at this stage, but suffice to say what we're very proud about in terms of these developments is the fact that they are on time and on budget. I don't know what the Australian construction sector is like, but certainly in the Auckland market, it is a very hot sector, an enormous amount of activity, cranes all over the skyline, and to be able to deliver these very significant projects, say, on time and on budget, I think is a real credit to the skill and sophistication of the team we've got at the moment. The picture on bottom right-hand corner of this chart I do just want to touch on for a moment, because one of the interesting things about the MetLife Care portfolio, we're one of the early movers in this sector in New Zealand, and as a consequence of that, some of our villages are 25, 30 years old. So we're one of an operator in the market that needs to confront sooner than others what you do with some of your ageing assets. The Pakaranga village, which is in Auckland, is a 30-year-old village where we're undertaking a major regeneration project at the moment. We're sitting on parcels of land, very valuable land that acquired decades ago, with relatively low-density developments on them originally, some of which are coming to the end of their economic lives. What we're getting a lot of experience as a company doing at the moment is regenerating, intensifying the land use at some of those locations, and you can see there at Pakaranga, we're doing that, and we're going through a purple patch of good architecture and design at the moment, and really starting to get some strong new economic value, as I say, out of very valuable land parcels that have got assets on them that are past their use-by date. I'll skip over this in the interest of time, but just in terms of the development pipeline going forward, as I say, from financial year 20 onwards, our ambition is to build 300 plus units a year, not necessarily in the Auckland region. This is a parcel of land that we have conditionally acquired, subject to Overseas Investment Office approval, in Auckland. It will be the site of a very attractive development. To give you a sense of the sort of thing that we are building, this is a 5.3-hectare site. It will ultimately be filled with 260-plus independent living units and 40 care beds. These are $200 million-plus developments, which we execute over phased periods. So one of the things we're conscious of as a business is not to take 250 units to market in a particular geography at one time. So part of the way we manage the strong development margins that we've been achieving as a business is first to do good fixed price contracting, which we've got a good track record of achieving. And secondly, staging these developments so that we can ensure that the market at any point in time is in a position to digest or absorb the production that we're putting into the market. In terms of highlights for the first half of financial year 18, We produced a net profit after tax of 56 million, which largely, a big contributor to that is the movement in the fair value of the property portfolio. As a business, we generate what we call underlying operating cash flows. It was 18 million in the period, but around $50 million on an annual basis. One of the attractions of the commercial, one of the attractions of the Aura model is its capital efficiency. When we build these developments, the intention in those projects is we draw down on our development debt facility during the construction phase of the village and then sell that down. And the intention at the end of the sell down process is to have no residual invested capital in the village. So extremely capital efficient. And then we go through this process of capital recycling that I described before. That is the beauty of the model. From a resident's perspective, you might ask, you know, what's in it for them paying a 30% DMF to get into these villages? From a resident's perspective, they're very attractive assets, an attractive environment to live in. For many of them, it provides them with a sense of community and a sense of security, and ultimately, if required, ready access to care and support. And the model, as I say, has worked well for many years. Total assets, to give you a sense of the size of the business, we have $3.1 billion New Zealand dollars again in total assets, as I mentioned before, embedded value of $277,000 a unit. Occupancy across the portfolio runs at 98%, and this is we describe it as the canary in the mine litmus test of demand for our product. So running at 90% village occupancy gives us a lot of comfort that there are strong waiting lists and good demand for the existing property. As I mentioned before, development margin in the first half of the year ran very strongly, and that was a combination of good contract pricing, fixed contract pricing that was set in the case of assets or new sales that we made in the first half of the year, pricing that was set 2 or 3 years ago, and we've enjoyed 2 or 3 years of house price inflation in the meantime, which has driven a strong sales figure. Net tangible assets sit at $6.63 New Zealand per share. As a company, we've traded historically at a discount to NTA and continue to do so. And we think the difference between our share price performance now and where it could and should be is execution and delivery of our development growth agenda. As I mentioned to you before, we're well on track to deliver what we said to the market we would deliver this financial year, and well on track to get to our run rate of 300 plus units a year from financial year 20. In terms of gearing, very lowly geared company. We have debt facility, a bank debt facility of $350 million, $140 million of which was drawn at 31 December. So the costs of the value of our existing construction work in progress, plus the expected costs to complete that work, is well within our banking headroom. We've got $160 million plus of flexibility, again, to run down the development growth agenda. In terms of dividend policy, we focus on what's called underlying operating cash flow, and that is the operating cash flows that you'll see reported for the business, and we extract new sales revenue from that number to get an underlying operating cash flow figure. And the reason we take new sales out is that cash we receive from the initial sell down on a village is used to repay directly the development debt facility that we've incurred in its construction. And so our view is that the underlying cash flow figure is the appropriate metric to focus on, and that's available for distribution to shareholders. And our policy on dividend distributions is to pay out roughly 30 to 50% of our underlying cash flow in each period. In this particular instance, for the first half of financial year 18, that was 3.25 cents, New Zealand cents per share. So in a nutshell, MetLife Care has been around for a long time in the New Zealand market. We've got a market capitalisation of $1.3 billion. As of today, a total book of assets of $3 billion. We trade at a discount to our net tangible asset backing, and that is really a reflection of our history as a company that's been very good at generating cash flow from its existing portfolio, but has had relatively modest development aspirations. Going forward, we're not going to be overly aggressive on development. We'd like to sort of believe that our strategy is centred around considered development in the New Zealand market, and at a rate where we think we can generate very good financial returns in the short term and ensure that we've got a quality book of retirement villages that will stand the test of time and generate good economic value for the business over the next 20 or 30 years. So on that note, that's all I have to say. I'm very happy to open the floor up to questions. Anybody?
What is the discount to NTA?
10%.
You said you have ILUs and care beds, and the cost of buying the care bed is what?
Cost of buying a care bed? Yeah. Yes, so two very different models. So in the independent living unit, those are ORA-style contracts, as I described. In care beds, we don't operate an ORA model. So in the care system, it's actually, we won't go into too much detail in this room on it. It's actually a very complicated formula that is means tested. So the amount you pay to occupy a care bed depends very much, or that you end up paying out of your own pocket, depends very much on the means testing that's applied in the New Zealand market. What I will say, though, is that the retirement village sector and MetLife Care provide a good service in many ways in the New Zealand market, because the retirement village operators build just about more care beds than anybody else. And the economic success of the care model depends very much on your ability to generate premium charges for your room, each room that's occupied. Across MetLife's care's portfolio, 10 to 12% of our portfolio is tied up in care-style beds, so it's not it's material, but certainly doesn't dominate the portfolio. Our occupancy runs at 93, 94% across the portfolio. But in all honesty, making big economic returns out of care is a very difficult exercise to undertake. In the retirement village model, the existence of care from an economic perspective needs to wash its face, but the value of it is really measured in terms of the appeal that it generates, or the demand that it generates for independent living in a particular location. So if people know they've got ready access to care, that obviously makes the ORA model much more effective. You get better prices, better capital recycling, and so care plays an indirect part in that formula.
In Australia, care beds, a nursing home would be considered not viable unless you have something like 100 beds,
mm-hmm,
or 70, 80 beds. Your bed size seems to be 37 beds. So are they profitable?
Yes, they are, as long as you get premium charging through. And we build, the size of our care facilities reflects two things. One, the scale economies of care facilities. So we believe that we can achieve scale at 36 to 40 beds within a village location. And secondly, based on your observation around how difficult it is to make good economic returns out of care, we tend to ensure that we build these things just the right size for the village, rather than building them any bigger than they need to be. I hope that makes sense.
Thank you, Richard. I think we'll have to cut that
all
off
done
there.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Richard. Our next speaker is the Chief Financial Officer of Genesis Energy, Chris Jewell. Thank you.
Kia ora, tēnā koutou katoa. We, as the third speaker or the fourth speaker, I realise I have to do a good job to keep the audience here today, and I'm going to try and get you very excited about the energy sector in New Zealand, which is in a very exciting space at the moment, despite some of the experiences you've seen in Australia. New Zealand is very different. The energy sector is very different. So you may have heard from some of the other presenters about why New Zealand, and Minister Sparker did a great job in selling New Zealand, and I was very pleased to see that some of the statistics he quoted were some of the statistics I've quoted on the board here. But one of the things I wanted to focus on was the energy sector in New Zealand and why that's different. One of the key differentiators is the stability of our regulatory environment, which is driven largely by a recent history of very stable governments. And we've only had two changes of government over the past 19 years, which is quite unique. The energy sector is entirely unsubsidised, and the development has been entirely market-driven, which again, on a global scale, is quite unique to have an entirely unsubsidised energy sector. New Zealand has achieved a 20% increase in renewable generation, and we're now an 80% renewable electricity sector, which is quite, on a global scale, there's only two countries that are that beat that from renewability. And it's well placed to be one of the first countries to electrify and decarbonise our transport fleet with entirely renewable electricity. And market signals have enabled the sector to deliver on the energy trilemma of affordability, environmental sustainability and security with very limited intervention. So the key message out of all of that is the sector is, it's unsubsidised, there's a very hands-off regulation and it's very driven by market signals. The close economic ties with Australia also ensures cooperation on matters of tax, which enables Genesis to pay supplementary dividends to Australian residents, ensuring tax neutrality. And there was a question earlier around tax and dividends, and we also pay supplementary dividends to make sure we impute our dividends at the moment are imputed to 80% as well, so the tax is paid to a level of 80%. On top of that, New Zealand's a great place to visit if you're into the outdoors and skiing and surfing, so if you're invested in Genesis, you can come and have a look one day and see some of the great assets that we've got as well. So let me tell you a little bit more about Genesis Energy. So Genesis is a vertically integrated energy management company, and through our joint venture with Beach Energy, Genesis owns 46% of Kupe, which is one of New Zealand's largest oil and gas and LPG fields. We use this in combination with rain, wind and sun to fuel our diverse set of thermal, hydro, wind and solar assets, which are spread across three distinct catchments, which you can see in the chart in front of you. And in a highly renewable electricity system, with limited hydro storage, thermal assets are very important to support the periods when the wind doesn't blow or it's not raining, and you might be surprised to know there are periods in New Zealand when it doesn't rain. It doesn't happen that often, but there are periods. And Genesis holds the strongest thermal position in New Zealand, and our dual-fueled thermal electricity assets are strategically located close to the major load centre in Auckland, and you heard the previous presenter talk quite a bit about Auckland and the demand growth in Auckland. It's the same with electricity. It's the largest. 30% of New Zealand's electricity is consumed in Auckland. And downstream, Genesis Energy is New Zealand's favourite energy retailer. We've got the largest customer base, and we're the only party that can offer three fuels on one bill. Now that might sound difficult, and you heard one of our presenters talk about Gentrack. It's actually very difficult to put gas, electricity and LPG all on one bill. So most of the companies in New Zealand, if you've got three different fuels, you get three different bills, and they all look different. We put it all on one bill, we've got one billing platform, and that is one of our, and we've got two brands, we can do that all under the same system architecture underneath. So it enables a seamless customer experience. So whilst we retain an acute focus on the traditional elements of the business being our generating assets, our differentiating factor will increasingly be our innovative approach to energy management for our customers, and we'll talk quite a bit about that this afternoon. Our vision is to be the first choice in energy management, and our purpose is to reimagine energy to put control in our customers' hands. Putting this all together, the diversity of Genesis's assets and customers ensures a strong, stable cash flow and a strong dividend stream. The market cap of Genesis Energy is $2.4 billion. The Crown owns 51%, and the balance is owned by a mix of global, institutional and retail investors. We have an entirely independent board, and our next biggest investor happens to be an Australian institutional, and they own 2% of Genesis. So just looking at some of the market fundamentals and the environment within which we operate. The fundamentals of the New Zealand energy markets remain strong. LPG demand growth has been growing strongly at 6% combined annual growth rates. Wholesale LPG prices are forecasted also to continue to strengthen. Electricity demand has been growing more slowly at around 1% per annum, but importantly, the electricity forward prices over the last year have increased about 5%. So unlike Australia, recent thermal closures have been very orderly, and the result of the market dynamics and growing has been the result of the market dynamics and growing carbon pricing. Whilst distributed solar is an energy management opportunity in New Zealand for retail businesses, at a wholesale level, given New Zealand is already at 80% renewable, the drivers for rapid and wide-scale installation are very different to the Australian experience. So we do expect to see more solar uptake in New Zealand, but we're very unlikely to get to the levels that you see, particularly in South Australia, with solar. We do see it likely that the transport sector will increasingly electrify, as I mentioned earlier. Separately, we've seen a rebound in oil prices over the past 12 months, which is very positive for Genesis. So just in summary, the market fundamentals, the market fundamentals for the energy sector in New Zealand remain very strong, with Genesis well positioned to participate in this growth as it occurs. So I've talked a little bit about the market, and I'm going to talk a little bit about why Genesis. And we've broken strategy down into three components, one being corporate strategy, one being our investor strategy, and the third being financial strategy. And I'll touch first on our company strategy. So we think about our company strategy. We've broken it down into five initiatives, and we all of the executives are incentivized around these five businesses, and we're driving the business around these five initiatives. So within the core business, we still have the opportunity for cost-based efficiencies, and we call this operational excellence. Specifically, we continue to improve our approach to asset management, spending the right amount of money at the right time on the right maintenance activities, and also digitising our customer experience and back-office call centres. And that is a real key opportunity for utilities, and that's a key focus for Genesis Energy. Secondly, we see a significant opportunity to improve margins in our residential sector through our innovative customer offerings. In many ways, our industry has let itself down with the sole focus on price competition at the expense of competition and innovation and outstanding service. With over 30 retailers, I thought there was 30, but the presentation on Gentrack indicated there was 40. It's growing. Energy retailing are growing rapidly in New Zealand. Competing on price is a race to the bottom, as the controllable costs of our retail business only represent a small portion of the total cost base. The majority of electricity switching activity is being driven by headline price discounting, and in a New Zealand context, that's largely through knocking on doors and incentivising you to switch retailer. Our strategy is very different. Our strategy is about growing margins by delivering unmatched service levels and differentiated products that give our customers comfort, convenience and control, and I'll bring this to life a little bit in a moment. So just to give you one example, it is highly conceivable that total customer bills reduce by 10% as an example, but our margins increase as customers are willing to pay more on a unit cost basis to reduce overall costs. So we are setting ourselves up to enable customers to manage their energy, overall reduce their cost base, but our margins should grow through time. Business customer growth is also a significant opportunity for Genesis, as we're currently under indexed to this high margin segment, and this segment has one of the highest propensities to take up energy management product offerings. Our focus is the growing agricultural and hospitality sectors, and if you've looked at New Zealand, you'll see that agriculture is one of the biggest drivers of GDP growth in New Zealand. The LPG category is one of the most exciting growth opportunities for Genesis. 10% of New Zealand houses have gas, and a further 10% of houses have LPG, which collectively leaves 80% of New Zealand houses with neither gas or LPG. LPG is growing rapidly due to the low rollout cost. It's great for water heating, it's great for space heating, it's also great for cooking. And unlike electricity with over 30 retailers, or 40 retailers, LPG has only 4 competitors. And Genesis is the only vertically integrated competitor in LPG, and we have a plan to totally own the LPG category. We're a very hungry new entrant, and we plan to significantly outperform in LPG and totally transform service standards in the LPG sector. Lastly, energy services. Think of energy as a service as opposed to electricity paid for on a unit rate. It's not inconceivable to visualise a product that sees you pay a fixed monthly fee for us to take care of all of your energy needs, and we commit to holding your house at a certain temperature, to keep your car fully charged, and to keep you with as much hot water as you would like on a daily or weekly basis. We could keep your solar we could optimise the use of your solar panels, and all the while giving you information to help you find ways to reduce this fixed monthly fee or your total energy bill. That is about energy as a service, and that's where we're going. This is energy services at its purest. These types of products will transform the industry and increasingly will become a core offering across all customers for Genesis Energy. So that was our strategy, and let me tell you how we're going on some of that. So we're only 18 months into the strategy set. Mark England is our chief executive who joined us. He previously ran the new energy business at AGL, and he's joined us as our chief executive in New Zealand and doing an outstanding job. Since this time, we've purchased an additional 15% of the Kupe oil and gas field to give us a controlling stake in the joint venture and also to give us a platform for the LPG growth that we talked about. We've launched New Zealand's first real-time community-based energy management testing environment where we're testing and learning of the types of products that I've described before we bring those to market. We purchased an LPG distribution business to give us the capability to compete on scale in LPG. And our thermal assets have supported New Zealand in 2 significant dry periods, further cementing their value in the eyes of the market. So we have quite a bit of momentum behind us, and we're excited about where we're going, and we've got a very clear plan. I'm just going to talk, of all of the things I've talked about, I'm just going to talk a little bit more about innovation. And in many ways, listening to some of the discussion earlier about particularly around Gentrack and Trade Me and the software companies, in many ways we're bringing technology and software to energy, which is very different for what you might hear other utility type companies talking about. So I'm going to explore a little bit more around the concept of energy management, and I gave you a couple of teasers of that earlier. So New Zealand has nearly 90% penetration of smart meters, which, unlike Australia, enables near real-time reads. We've just developed a product through our smartphone app that we believe is a world first. Using your smart metering data, some smart algorithms, weather prediction data, we're able to break down your energy consumption into the various components of heating, lighting, fridges, air conditioning, etc. And we're now able to forecast your usage over the next 7 days, and we believe that's a world first. We can send you an alert to tell you your pool pump comes on in the middle of the day, and you might actually save a little bit of money by setting it up to run in the evenings, or that we notice your fridge seems to be using more energy than it normally does, and it might be worth getting your tradesman around to have a look at that. Maybe that's at the end of its life. So our app is becoming a central portal for all of your energy needs. As a customer, when the next headline price discount arrives on TV or the next person knocks on your door, why would you leave Genesis if the competitors can't offer you this service? So the game for us in our customer business is all about churn reduction and margin expansion through improved service offering and innovation in product development. Our aspiration in driving loyalty is about customers having the freedom to leave, but they choose to stay. And that's very different to a lot of the traditional utility models where you get bundled together in a long-term contract, and frankly, you'd like to leave, but you're locked in and you're quite upset about that. So just to repeat that, our aspiration is customers having the freedom to leave at any point they like, but they choose to stay. And we often get asked why won't others just copy what you're doing? And this all sounds pretty easy, but it's easy to copy. Genesis now has over 150 people working in a scaled, agile development methodology. And the Genesis culture has enabled us to be faster at product development than our competitors, and it's all about being one step ahead. The agile methodology is very common in software development companies, such as Spotify, and I'm pretty sure that Trade Me uses this as a methodology for its own product development also. And it allows you to have much faster development timeframes, and we talk about minimum viable products, and we take things to market before they're quite ready, and we use customers to learn and test, and then we roll out the final product. And this is a key competitive difference for Genesis. And having talked to a lot of other investors who we see regularly, we often get the comment that they haven't heard energy companies or utility companies talk about culture as a key point of difference. So from a financial strategy, we've talked a little bit about corporate strategy. We'll talk a little bit now about financial strategy. When we set our financial strategy, we were targeting top quartile total shareholder return, which in today's environment equates to 14%. We have valued up all the initiatives that I've talked about earlier today, and we have plans to enable the delivery of each of these value components. And our aim is to be a $400 million EBITDAF company by 2021. So now just looking at our investor strategy. So with a top quartile total shareholder return, you should think of us as a yield stock with growth potential. Total shareholder return will be delivered 50-50 through share price appreciation and 50% through dividends. Our dividends at our recent half year computed at a 6.7% net yield, and our dividend policy is about growing total dividends in real terms over time. So inevitably, strategy has to flow through to numbers and results. So just having a look at our half-year results, which we announced 2 weeks ago. EBITDAF was up 28% on the prior comparable period. Underlying earnings was up 14%. Operating cash flow was up 15%. And additionally, over the past 12 months, we've outperformed our peer group on total shareholder return by 4%. And that's quite significant. Total shareholder return was 29%. We've outperformed our peers by 4%, we've outperformed the index by 7%. So we feel we're well on the way to delivering on our target of $400 million by 2021. So just a couple of final points. Capital structure, we are a BBB+ rated entity with quite a diversified balance sheet with an average tenure of 11 years. At the half year, we also announced a dividend reinvestment plan to help rebuild our balance sheet after quite a significant period of acquisitive growth. So just to wrap up, why Genesis? One final pitch on the strategic differentiators within the New Zealand energy market construct. So we are the only New Zealand energy company focused on energy as a service, and the only company able to offer three products on one technology platform. We have a very diverse set of assets ensuring stable earnings and have a position of strength in the thermal market, which ensures a security of supply in a highly renewable and volatile market. And this thermal strength will increasingly become more important as New Zealand transitions towards the government target of 100% renewable market by 2035 in a normal hydrology year. And I stress that normal hydrology year, you still need thermal in a 100% renewable market in New Zealand. We are the only truly vertically integrated energy company, creating value through integrating the upstream, midstream and downstream. And finally, as I mentioned earlier, we're developing a culture that will enable us to be the first to market through embedding the agile development methodology. And just to recap on our strategy and investor proposition, we have a well thought out, well costed strategy across five strategic initiatives with a financial strategy that will deliver EBITDAF of $400 million by 2021, which translates to top quartile total shareholder performance for which you as investors and potential investors should enjoy. So thank you. Happy to take any comments or questions.
Thank you, Chris. Do we have any questions?
That is extremely impressive. Maybe you guys should be talking to someone in South Australia as far as how this whole thing works. Anyway, in terms of the renewables, you said you're very independent, you're not subsidized, and you take it all from the market, and the market drives the business. Give me an idea as to how the subsidy doesn't work, because the world market is talking about renewable energy, and it's talking about subsidization from one organization to another.
Sure.
So how does it work for you guys?
So in a New Zealand construct, 15 years ago, we were 60% renewable, and I was involved in another competing energy company at that point. And we just made 10%. We built nearly 1,000 megawatts of renewable generation, or New Zealand built 1,000 megawatts of geothermal generation, totally unsubsidised, just based on the forward markets, and the economics all stood up. We forward sold a lot of that energy into the market, and that gave us the financial backing to build geothermal at the time. Other competitors have done that through wind, totally unsubsidised, and just with pure market mechanisms. And our experience is the best regulation has been to be hands-off, let the market create the mechanisms to enable that growth. Totally unsubsidised.
So am I to believe that whatever's going around in the world market as far as subsidisation from other countries or from people that are not able to do the energy creation without being subsidised is not affecting you guys?
I think the difference in New Zealand, there's two key differences. In New Zealand, we're blessed with renewable resources. A lot of parts of the world aren't blessed with the same renewable resources. Australia is a good example. And the other point I'd make is our thermal fuels were relatively expensive relative to the cost of our thermal resources. So I can't comment on the subsidisation schemes in other parts of the world, but those were two key points that enabled the rapid rollout of renewables in New Zealand.
Last question.
Being the Australian, we got to rely on wind energy. What percentage of renewables in New Zealand are based on wind?
It's 10% at the moment, and I suspect if we were to get to from 80% to 100% renewable, I suspect the last 20% will largely be wind and a little bit of geothermal.
What's the return on the wind energy over in New Zealand?
What's the return on wind energy? It gets a return at the forward market rate, so it's probably earning a 10 to 12% return.
Why doesn't it work in Australia then?
Again, I haven't studied the Australian market, but I suspect it's the difference in cost. But you've got a lot of cheap coal, which means when you've got very low average fuel prices, it's very hard to build wind farms.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I will have to cut it off there because we're running about 15 minutes late. But thank you very much, Chris. There is a $100 FPOS prize to be raffled off at the end of the last presentation. Our next speaker is the upcoming CEO of EBOS Group, John Cullity.
That $100 sounds pretty good.
Sorry, can we have the microphone fixed, please?
Working now? Is that better? Sorry, so I'll start again. My name's John Cullity. I'm representing EBOS today. I'm currently the CFO for EBOS, and on the 31st of March, I moved to the CEO position, succeeding Patrick Davies. It's my pleasure to present to you today on our company. I direct your attention, firstly, to the bottom of this slide. So EBOS is a New Zealand company, and its market capitalisation is just under $3 billion. And we have revenues of north of $7.5 billion. And I'm informed that makes us New Zealand's third largest company by revenue. And over recent years, we've been delivering very strong returns. And over the last 4 years, we've delivered 21% shareholder return. Our business today comprises two principal segments, healthcare and animal care. Our healthcare segment represents approximately 80% of the business, with animal care 20%. We're a very diversified group, and we've had a deliberate strategy of diversifying our business. The backbone of our business, and in effect the legacy of EBOS, has been pharmaceutical wholesaling into community pharmacy and the hospital channel across Australia and New Zealand. We are in effect distributing drugs and other goods into pharmacy and into hospital in those two markets, in those two regions. But more than that, we have been investing in other industries or in other markets within healthcare. For instance, we are the majority shareholder in the TerryWhite Chemmart management company. TerryWhite Chemmart today is Australia's leading retail pharmacy network by store numbers. For point of clarification, we don't own the pharmacy stores. Our investment is in the management company that acts as the franchisor that runs that network. Towards the end of last year, we took a minority investment in MedAdvisor, another Australian listed company. MedAdvisor is Australia's leading digital management company. It has over 1 million consumers using its application, and it has a network of basically half the retail pharmacy network in Australia. We've been investing also in consumer products brands. We're known for two well-known brands and others, but principally Faulding and Red Seal. Red Seal is a predominant brand in the New Zealand market, selling its products into both the pharmacy and grocery channel. In the most recent half, Red Seal delivered growth in the New Zealand market, domestic growth, of just under 8%. Its products are ones that we're looking to take into overseas international markets in the medium term. Another significant strength of the EBOS business is what we refer to as the institutional healthcare market. And this principally comprises distribution of pharmaceutical products into the hospital channel. We are the leading provider of that service in both Australia and New Zealand by a long way. But more than that, we also have the EBOS healthcare business. And that acts as the marketer and distributor of medical consumables into hospitals, aged care facilities, GP clinics. And midway through last year, we acquired a business called HPS, which is Australia's leading provider of outsourced pharmacy services to the private hospital market in Australia. In some private hospitals that you go to in Australia and you walk in the door and you see the pharmacy, you might notice that that pharmacy is branded HPS. That business is owned today by EBOS. We've had a deliberate strategy, therefore, of building out our legacy pharmaceutical distribution business to invest in further ancillary assets within the healthcare segment. Within our animal care business, which I mentioned comprises approximately 20% of the group, we've got, a very diversified portfolio of assets. We're the owners of the Black Hawk pet food brand, owners of VitaPet, which is a pet treats brand, and also owner of the Master Pet Pet Accessories brand. We also hold an investment, a 50% investment, in the Animates Pet retail store chain in New Zealand. It's a retail store chain of approximately 50 stores. And we also operate the number two vet wholesaler in Australia by the name of Lippard. So all in all, you can see EBOS comprises
many businesses, many brand names, and many assets. Our strategy is very well defined and has been very successful and can be summarised across three key themes: investing for growth, occupying leading market positions, and disciplined capital management. The business segments that we operate in, of healthcare and animal care, have very strong underlying economic fundamentals. We're attracted to those business segments and we're attracted to further investment in them. We've been very active on the M&A front over a number of years. It goes to the core of the EBOS strategy. But not only that, we've been reinvesting significantly in our business and principally our distribution centre facilities throughout Australia. That's about making sure that we're the most efficient operator in our industry in this market. Over the last 4 years, we've probably allocated or invested just under $500 million of capital on either investing in acquisitions or in capital expenditure. And all of that growth and all of that investment has been funded by internal sources. We're very disciplined with our capital management. In our business, cash is as important as profit. Cash generation goes to the heart of our strategy. We run our businesses for cash, we reward our shareholders with increased returns, and we take the available cash to reinvest and acquire further businesses in either healthcare or animal care. We're very strategic with our investments. To date, they have been focused across both Australia and New Zealand only. Any acquisition opportunity must meet with our strategic direction, and they must satisfy our internal hurdles, investment hurdles. The group today has a return on capital of just over 16%. I mentioned before that we've been very active on the M&A front, and over the last 18 months, we've completed a number of transactions that are on the left-hand side. I've talked about TerryWhite Chemmart, I've talked about the HPS investment. Blackhawk was a business that we acquired just on 3 years ago. And due to its success in the Australian marketplace, we launched Blackhawk into New Zealand effective July. And it's been a very successful uptake from consumers in that market. I'll talk a little bit now about our capacity expansion or our capital expenditure, because over the last 7 years, we've invested north of $100 million on replacing our principal distribution centre facilities across the Australian Eastern Seaboard. But it's been more than just replacement. These are now highly automated facilities. The drive for efficiency has driven us to that level of investment. Labour costs comprise over half of the total costs of running that business. In order to be the leading industry operator, we have to invest in automation and maximise the amount of efficiencies that we can generate. That investment program comes to its conclusion at the end of this calendar year when we open our new distribution facility in the Brisbane market. I've briefly touched on Blackhawk. This is a pet food brand that's now Australia's fastest growing premium pet food brand. It has a leading position in the pet specialty retail channel in both Australia and New Zealand. Its growth rates has exceeded all expectations. It's found a real niche in the marketplace, and it's been able to capitalise on the fact that consumers are prepared to spend that little bit extra on their pets. In the most recent half, we reported sales growth for Blackhawk of 26%. That was just in Australia. And in the medium term, it's another product that we'll look to take to overseas markets. For those investors following the pet space, it's a pretty hot space right now. You may be aware that earlier this week, General Mills announced the acquisition of Blue Buffalo at multiples north of 20 times EBITDA. for that particular business. Last week, we released our first half results, and once again, it was a continuation of the strong financial performance that we've had over the last 4 years. We had underlying EBITDA growth of just under 10%. The EBITDA growth in healthcare was just under 9%, and the animal care segment reported EBITDA growth of 12%. Importantly, we also confirmed profit guidance for the full year of underlying constant currency EBITDA growth of 10% on FY17. And pleasingly, our cash performance was a record result. We generated cash before CapEx of just over $100 million, and that allowed us to keep our net debt to EBITDA ratio of under 1.8 times. It also assisted in allowing us to keep our return on capital employed of just over 16%. If I focus your attention on the left-hand side and to the EBITDA chart, in FY14, we were generating EBITDA of $175 million. Based on our guidance for FY18, we'll generate EBITDA of approximately $270 million. That's all come from successful execution of our strategy and acquisitions. There's been no capital raise during that period. We've also lifted dividends by over 50%, and for Australian investors, our dividends are fully franked, and the share price has responded accordingly. Where to from here for EBOS? We'll continue to execute on our strategy of both organic growth and inorganic growth via bolt-on acquisitions. We see a good pipeline of opportunities for us to pursue in both the healthcare and animal care space. We'll continue to maintain our discipline on capital management, and we'll continue to maintain our focus on generating superior shareholder returns. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, John. We are running a little late. I'll just take one or two quick questions before we move on. John, it looks like you must have been covered all grounds.
Excellent.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Our final speaker is the Chief Business Development Officer of Pushpay Holdings, James Mayocco.
All right, I know I'm the last speaker, and I'm standing between you and happy hour, so we'll make this quick. And I want you to come away with just three things before I get started. One is that the generosity market is huge. Number two, Pushpay is uniquely positioned to win. And number three, we're just getting started. So what's the problem? What does Pushpay do? So for those of you who have attended church, many of you may know that the faith market is stuck in the world of Windows 95. All of you have a smartphone in your pocket, and you can buy a song on iTunes, you know, with a press of a button for 99 cents. But if you're at church and you're moved by a sermon, or if you support a not-for-profit and you're moved by a cause, your ability to give is very difficult. And that is a problem that we aim to solve. Number two is that we're going to go after this by doing it with a mobile-first strategy. By doing so, we're trying to raise the expectations of what consumers in the pews and who support not-for-profits, what they expect every day. What you see here, for instance, on the left-hand side, is the experience at Amazon this past Christmas. Over 70% of all interactions with Amazon before someone made a purchase was done over a mobile device. 70%. On the flip side over here, which is the faith market in the United States, which is over $120 billion in giving, less than 15%, only 13% is given digitally. Now that might be hard for you to believe, but 87% is done by cash and check. Cash and check. So as a result, if you are at church and you're moved, the ability to give. No one has a cash or check on them anymore. My kids, who are millennials, don't even own a checkbook. So churches have to make this leap, and this is what PushPay is doing. We're helping churches transform and deliver an expectation that people have when they use Uber, Spotify, and Apple on their phone. So how does PushPay do it? So first and foremost, we do have to collect cash and check. We have to be able to have the ability for churches to track and capture check, cash and check. But we also want to capture every other way somebody can give, whether it be online, with a credit card, via kiosk, or text. But the trick, the secret sauce is that we're going to take every one of those interactions and drive it to mobile. So if you go sign up for Facebook, they're going to drive you to mobile. If you're going to sign up for Amazon, they're going to drive you to mobile. Every consumer application you use drives you to mobile, because you spend on average 4 hours a day on a mobile device. So no different that we should be doing the same thing in the faith market. And that's why we're having such great success. So if you look at our numbers over the last year, if you look at our stock performance since we've listed on the ASX, we've had a remarkable run, and we're just getting started. We're world class in terms of the SaaS metrics you might expect, well over 95% annualized revenue retention, less than 12 months cost to recover in terms of an investment. So that means if we put a dollar in, we will recover that cost fully within a year. And you know, if you look at the growth, we've pulled in many of our targets. We just eclipsed over $100 million in annual committed monthly revenue at the end of December. We actually pulled that forward a quarter. We only know of one other company that's ever been faster than us in doing that across the entire planet. And we are now at the point where, with over 7,000 customers, we are the fifth largest provider of apps in the world on the Apple and Google Play stores. That's across every single industry. We are the fifth largest provider of apps in the world. And we're just getting started. So let's talk a little bit about our performance. So we've laid out a number of targets over the past quarters. We've hit every single one of them. We've made a statement to the market that we're going to be cash flow positive by the end of the year, and we're on target to do so. So we're very excited. Keep track of this and continue to watch our performance as we push out our operating updates. Here's what our revenue trajectories have looked like. So again, this is annualized committed monthly revenue. And if you look back just even less than 3 years ago, we've more than tripled that. Just growing up and to the right. Why is that? Because we continue to make more money, and we continue to help the churches and the not-for-profits who work with us be successful. In fact, we are so confident that we actually guarantee a church that we will increase their giving. And churches in America, for those of you who have not been to church in America, church is a very big cultural thing. It is a high attendance. Our largest church, we have the largest church in America, has over $100 million annual budget. They have 40,000 people attend every weekend. 40,000 people. Huge, huge organizations. So as a result, we participate in their success. And as we help people drive towards a mobile engagement, instead of being 15% digital, we can get them to 25, 30, and in some of our largest churches and some of our most successful implementations, as high as 80% mobile. Right? It's the same transition that everyone has seen in terms of purchasing music and in terms of using retail banking. Right? Everyone's gone to mobile. If you look at our cohorts is just a fancy word for tracking a group of customers that started in a particular year. So this is a group of customers that started in FY15, and you see how it grew the following year. This is a cohort of customers that started in that year, and then they grew the following year. So what you see is we make an investment in a set of customers, get them on board, and then we grow them and help them be successful. So we don't just stop with selling them a solution. We actually come and work alongside them and invest in coaching and implementation and best practices so that they can learn from one another. What are the ways in which you can drive more mobile engagement? Because I don't know about you, but I feel great about what we do every day, because the more successful we are in helping these churches, the more people they get fed, the more women that get served in a battered shelter. You know, the things that we do, the stories you hear, the homes that get built after a hurricane, it's an incredible experience. And that's as a mission-driven, it allows us to attract great talent and people who are willing to work incredibly hard to have an impact on the world. Now, this is a fancy term. It's called CAC to LTV divided by CAC ratio. What this means is if you take the lifetime value of a customer and you divide it by the cost of us acquiring it, we get greater than $10, a 10x multiple back. That means if I put a dollar in today, we're going to get greater than $10 back in return on investment. What this is telling us is we should keep investing very aggressively in growing the business. And we're going to do that while also becoming cash flow positive this year. This is just an example of what our apps look like. We can give you a variety of different examples of different churches and not-for-profits that utilize our apps today. And here's just a couple key strategic initiatives. Number one is we've got to hire world-class talent. We've grown from, you know, literally dozens of people to almost 400 people in the last 3 years, right? So, and what's amazing about that, we've been able to do this with this great metrics, but we also are doing it by bringing in really great talent while also growing talent inside the business. We have about 100 people in Auckland today and about 300 people up in Seattle. That's why I've got this funny American accent, right? And part of it, too, is that we're trying to attract, I'm one of the few folks who has gray hair inside the business. We have a lot of young people. But part of that is you have to shepherd these people along and help them be successful. And so I've been fortunate. I've been at Microsoft. I was one of the executives at Xero early days with Rod. And there's also a variety of other folks we try to grab from Salesforce, Tableau, what have you. People who've been there and done that, so you can have confidence that we're making investments to scale the business. Secondly, one of the other initiatives for us is to continue to drive this engagement towards mobile. We started in the payments area and finances, like that was the low-hanging fruit. Churches often ask you to give time, treasure, and talent, so we did very well with treasure as the first thing to do. Hey, how do we help drive revenue for the church to support their ministries? But the other things we need to start thinking about, how do we drive time and talent? How do we get people involved? So we made a very heavy investment in mobile over the last 2.5 years, and that's how it has just taken off for us. It's not only increased revenue, but it's also increased engagement and participation in the church. As we move forward, we've been very explicit about saying that, hey, we're going to go down the market of investing in events and analytics, help people think about the faith market with real best practices. How do I benchmark? How am I performing? Franchises do this, so why aren't we doing this in the faith market? We should not be under-investing in something that has such a positive impact on our communities. And then obviously communications in terms of how do people engage and bring people on a journey through their faith congregation. Lastly, I just want to highlight the fact that we have just 2% of the market today. We manage over $2.2 billion in transaction volume through the end of October last year. And we're just getting started. So again, the three things I told you. One is that the generosity market, it's massive. Number two, PushPay is uniquely positioned. And number three, we're just getting started. So thank you very much. I'll open it up for questions.
Oh, hello. Very impressive. Thank you. Quick question. So, just to confirm, you're based in New Zealand, your main market is the US, and you're listed in Australia.
Yes. Thank you for asking that question. So the company started in New Zealand. Chris and Elliot, the two co-founders, went to church. They were very moved by one of their pastor's sermons they wanted to give, etc., and that's how the company was born. However, there's only a small handful of churches in New Zealand. And after winning those churches and demonstrating the market value proposition, they began to look at, hey, where's the largest market opportunity? And unequivocally, it's the United States, right? So just the amount of money that's given in the United States eclipses, obviously, the New Zealand economy, right? It's actually over $300 billion if you include not-for-profits. In terms of the financing journey, the company started as a listed company in New Zealand just because there's not a strong seed financing early stage angel investment community. At least there wasn't 5 years ago. It's improving now, but it wasn't at that time. So they started as a listed company to raise their money. As they move forward to grow the company, I joined the company as well. And part of it was to come in and say, hey, look, we need to get on a recognized exchange, which was Australia. New Zealand is not a recognized exchange in the United States by many of the major trading houses. So to drive greater volume and bring more revenue into the business, we listed on the Australian exchange last year. We do have lots of customers in Australia. We have a lot of customers in New Zealand as well. But the payments markets here are regulated. And as a result, the margin opportunity here is very small. Whereas in the United States, it's an unregulated market and there's loads of opportunity. Good question.
Thank you. The other question is, I saw you're planning a listing in the US.
That's correct.
This year.
Yes.
Can you just talk a little bit about that, please?
Yeah. Access to the US markets just is, again, going to increase capital for the business. As we look ahead, we want to be able to have more capital continue to grow quickly. The numbers you saw earlier, as I was highlighting the LTV to CAC ratio, tells us that we should continue to invest very aggressively to grow the business, whilst also being cash flow positive. With the additional capital raise and access to markets, we'll get greater liquidity, better balance in terms of the valuation on the stock, and at the same time, be able to have more cash to grow the business.
I was just wondering, apart from churches, do you have any other sort of nonprofits on board?
Yeah, we do. We have hundreds of not-for-profits and schools. But at this point right now, we continue to support not-for-profits and schools that reach out to us, that come inbound to us from a business standpoint. We're not actively marketing to them. So many, many people, if you give a dollar to your church, you are likely to give to 7 other not-for-profits and schools, right? So it's a natural affinity. I attend a church. My kids attended the school attached to my church, and there's a homeless shelter associated with my church, which is a separate not-for-profit. So all those are prospective customers. However, given how small of the market penetration we have at only 2%, the best return we can drive for shareholders is just to remain very focused. Because as you go into not-for-profits and if you go into education, there's some very unique product requirements that are different. And right now, while we have about 100 people in product, we don't have enough product people to start adding and going after these additional product requirements. So what we'd like to do is, hey, how do we grow from 2% to 6% to 12% to 20% in the faith market? If we do those things and start throwing off a lot of cash, then we can make those investments for schools and not-for-profits as well. We don't say no to them. We're just not building any unique opportunities or going to market at right now. So.
Am I to understand that you're busting the myth of people not going to church and the church faith dwindling?
Just the opposite in the United States. So attendance in the United States in small rural churches is down, but overall attendance in churches in America is up. And what's amazing about that is if you look at the numbers, people are attending through multiple different venues. I'll give you a great example. Mosaic Church in Hollywood has 1,500 people per week that attend the church, but they have another 15,000 that watch it online that same day, and another 25,000 people that watch it online during the week. Their number one giver, their number one donor to that church, lives in North Carolina, and the church is in California, right? So people are participating with church in a different way. So attendance in the pews might look differently, but attendance and participation in church is increasing. And the best part about it is generosity in America is growing 3% per year, compounded every year, faster than U.S. economy, and is recession-proof. It doesn't go down when the economy is tinkering. So it's an amazing market. And there is more latent generosity there if we make it more convenient. We've seen that.
Hi. Thank you very much for bringing this very innovative and in the community in yep. worldwide, yes. My question is, how's the company balance between the profit for the shareholder and the generosity world that to be seen as the ethical? I know it's a very smart way to.
That's
do
a great
it,
question. But, so, yeah. if I was
what's your thought in philosophy on this? Yeah.
So you're asking a question about the ethics of us being a profitable company in the not-for-profit and faith sector. Great question. I love this question. So if we believe that the church does great things, then we need to find a vehicle to invest in that technology that is off the charts. And what we can prove is that for every person who goes on PushPay, we guarantee an increase that will far and eclipse any amount of money that they will pay us. And our take in terms of the processing volumes is at market rates or lower, right? So they're not paying anything additional. In fact, the average donation on PushPay today is $197 per click. $197, that's a lot more than an iTunes song. And the best part about that is that other than a Sunday, the next most frequent day that people give is on a Friday morning, because people get paid every other Friday in America, right? And so we see 65% of all donations come not on a Sunday. It's amazing, right, when you consider the fact that checkbooks and cash don't come with you if there's rain or snow or Johnny's got a soccer game. Now all of a sudden people can participate and they can still give. So it's fantastic. And by the way, great question, but we always are able to overcome that.
Yep. We have one final question up there and then we'll wrap up.
So my question is with regards to your competitors. Like, you are a software company, yep, I believe, and I'm sure there are other competitors who are also developing same kind of software. And are there any threats from your large companies like Xero who might acquire you?
Yeah, so great question. I obviously know the Xero team very well, as I was one of the executives there for a couple of years. So first and foremost is that people in the faith market buy from people who believe what they believe. So when you look at our competition, all of our competitors were started by pastors or pastors and their wives. No joke. They are small companies. I think the largest competitor we have has about 35 employees that focus in on the giving space. We have over 400. I mean, we have just under 400 employees right now, right? And no one is resourced or has the types of financing that we have at PushPay. So we actually don't view our competition at all in terms of the faith tech market, the Kindreds, the Secure Gives. Where we view our competition for the church is Instagram, Facebook, Spotify. These are the things that capture the attention. This is where people spend 4 hours a day. So what we have to do is help the church be relevant in an age in which kids are distracted, millennials are distracted, parents are distracted. So unless we make it convenient and easy to do, then, hey, we're not going to be successful, right? So that's where we see our competition. We just do not really have any significant competition in the market we serve today. I'll remain available afterwards. I know we had to finish up time-wise, but thank you for your questions.
A great presentation, and very smart of you to finish speaking early and take all those questions and feed that curiosity. As I've promised, we've got the raffle now. The room is a little emptier than it was at the start, so you'll have to bear with me until we ensure that we've got someone in the room. Henry Cuey? Oh, well, there you go, first try. Congratulations. Thanks, everyone. That's it for today, and hope to see you back next month for our next session.